I'd say probably the biggest one single change or influence in metal in the last 10 years has been the internet.
The internet's changed everything in the past decade.
The internet's changed music.
Oh, the monster, the internet.
The internet is the new radio.
It just made everything better. It's the fucking internet. I mean, how did it make your fucking life better? Are you kidding me?
What is an internet? Would you mind just, you know, sharing that with us?
The internet obviously is the nationwide network of networks communication. And to this day, more than 60% of the traffic on the internet is email.
And everybody eventually in this country, will everybody be somehow hooked into an internet in the next 5, 10, 15 years?
If we have anything to do about it, yes, I will.
Fenrez from Dark Throne, you know, has said that he loves MySpace, you know, and like you would think that MySpace is like the least black metal thing ever. But on the other hand, as you know, someone who came up through the scene through tape trading, like why wouldn't you love MySpace? You know, it's like a tape trader's dream.
The internet's also made it so that any band can be heard. You're no longer limited by being signed to a record label or having your CD in stores or having enough money to get CDs pressed or any of that.
There's so many of these European bands that who knows if we ever would have heard of them if it wasn't for the internet.
And the internet broke down barriers. Now, you know, bands are on the same level as the listener.
When you start seeing from the business perspective of things, analytics being based off of, you know, unique impressions, eyeballs, clicks like that, before you see album sales, it has a huge, profound impact.
Though they say the music industry is dying, I think it's at one of its strongest points ever on a musical side, because more music is being consumed now more than any other time.
Isn't that what we want? Everyone to hear good music, and it's all there. And then plus you have, you know, websites like Metal Injection, Metal Sucks, who are actually putting it out there to people. They're tastemakers.
And it's so easy. All you do is point and click.
But how does it work?
All you need is a computer and a regular phone line.
I think it has made it absolutely impossible to have that feeling that I had when I was 16.
There used to be an art to like the record store and searching for something in like a mail order and a CD distro or whatever.
You had to take a chance on buying a record, you know what I mean? Like you had $15 to spend on a record or a CD, and oftentimes you didn't know what the hell the record was gonna sound like because you couldn't really preview it.
It was kind of like an investment. Even if you didn't like it the first time, you're like, man, I paid $14, I'm gonna listen to this damn record 3 or 4 times.
People like my nieces who are like 16 and 14, they don't have the same experience with music that I do. They just wanna hear something, they know how to download it and get it for free. They don't care about artwork. They don't care about lyrics. They don't care about reading, you know, other bands' names that are in the thank yous.
You got to judge it in the most honest way possible, because you either heard the music or somebody you trusted told you about it, and that was enough.
Change. It's just changed media in general. I mean, entire industries are collapsing because of the internet.
When I was growing up with metal, it was Headbangers Ball, and it was, you know, picking up Metal Maniacs and Circus and Metal Edge and, you know, Hit Parade or Rip, finding out what these bands were, like, after the fact, because they're in the magazine, you already know it's kind of late.
In the past, like, a publicist would set up a campaign. First press release to Hit Parade and Metal Maniacs would be in the studio now, they're working on a new album. Maybe you'd hint at, you know, what the album title is going to be, et cetera, et cetera. The issue after, you'd have the big 5-page feature or 10-page feature, whatever it is. Maybe you'd have the review of the album. And the issue after that, you'd have, okay, they just played LA or New York, and there'd be like the live review of the show. So basically, you spread your information over a 4 or 5 month campaign. Now, when the publicist's here, every hour he's got to put something out on Twitter.
For me, it's sad seeing the decline of print media. I'm like one of those old school guys. I like to go pick up the magazine at the newsstand and see like a tangible result of my work. And now, you know, the bosses are kind of forcing me to look at it the other way. It's like, forget about this. It's all online. And then, yeah, 75% of all press now is moving into that. That arena, you know, I mean, it's great for places like Metal Injection, Metal Sucks.
Internet, the thing that's going to make my job obsolete.
What is it?
This, Jen, is the internet.
Actually, honestly, for me, the internet is a godsend. I couldn't do the magazine nearly as efficiently as we do it without the internet. I've been involved in you know, music publishing since 1996, and there was a time when not everybody had email. You'd have to like wait for them to fax in their reviews and then retype it. And labels would overnight slides or prints to you. They couldn't email you like a band photo. You had to either own like a high-powered scanner that can scan slides or take it to some place that could do it. And like there were just so many steps. I know this probably sounds like the Stone Age to people who were born in the 90s, but you know, it really was like that.
I don't know that it necessarily has changed the way that I do things as a magazine editor too much, but it does crystallize a certain understanding of what a magazine is for and what a magazine can do that other mediums, particularly, you know, blogs and the internet, can't do. Really awesome original photography is something that, you know, maybe at some point you'll see people on the internet doing, but right now you don't really see so much of that. And two is really, really like long in-depth stories. You know, blogs are trending towards microblogs, towards Twitter, and you know, like even shorter snippets of information. And so myself as a magazine editor, you know, I need to trend the other way, which is to do even, you know, longer, more in-depth, you know, historical type stories.
You really have to think when you do a record and the band goes into the studio of all your extras.
So we're kind of taking in these old school, you know, promotional tactics and kind of bringing in these new school interventions and kind of mixing and matching.
Earth's Blood, it's like we didn't really have a whole lot going on. We didn't tour a lot before the record. We didn't have a record out for a few years. Everything was all internet. You know, it was all what kind of contests can we run? What, you know, how can we release information about the album, the artwork, the, you know, the videos about the making of the album and all that stuff. And it seemed to work really well. It was all created really with very little money.
And I've personally been shifting a lot more of my advertising towards online because once again, we're able to track it and we're actually able to see an increase in sales when certain banner ads hit in this region and this region, opposed to magazines where it's, you really can't track it as well. So definitely on a business side, I think the internet's helped a lot.
That's a really good thing because you don't have to rely on someone spending $4, $5, $10 to buy a magazine, flip through the magazine, see your ad, you know, that can just be on a website or your website, for instance, to be like, oh, look, who is this band? There was a little animated banner, that looked cool, I like that artwork, let me click on them.
We struggle now to get our records in the stores, like Target you have to pay for, Walmart will not take a band like Dying Fetus, obviously. So this leaves us with very few outlets. You can offer tens of thousands of products online. You can ship worldwide. You can access it 24 hours a day as well. So it's definitely cool that if you are a diehard fan who wants to buy product, you have that at your fingertips.
But now you have this band store. Buy your tickets here. Buy your, you know, your ringtones here. Buy your t-shirts here. Buy the CDs. Here's my tour dates. It's a little, it's a micro store instead of a mega store. But you almost like you have online 100,000 micro stores.
I find it's a little bit more difficult to find really good bands because there's so much filler out there and you really have to spend just hours, you know, kind of sifting through everything to find one all right band, you know.
You know, some of the younger bands haven't been allowed the time to mature and kind of discover really where they're going and evolve properly. So I think that it's, while again it has made it easier for people to hear stuff, it's made it easier for people to hear a lot of shitty stuff.
Most metalheads don't want to do all the work to be introduced to all the new music. The internet, you have to, I mean, sit there and be a nerd, you know, some sort of radio programmer in your basement doing things to find out all these different bands, searching yourself. Sometimes it's easy just to press play or turn on your stereo and hear what comes out and, like old school radio, be introduced.
I was also told a long, long time ago is you don't sell a CD, don't think in terms of selling a CD, you're selling a lifestyle.
MySpace became this kind of benchmark. You know, if you didn't have X amount of friends or plays, you couldn't get on this tour, or you couldn't get signed. And the thing that surprised me, because at first I thought it was very hype driven, like I didn't believe that it was real, but it was. You know, those bands, you know, bands like Joffrey Cowboy and Suicide Silence and In This Moment were signees based a lot on their MySpace performance. It translated into real record sales.
And that's where people are going to date these days. That's where people are going to discover music. It is you know, we always joked about Second Life and Half-Life when those things came out. The social networks are those now. You know, it's your virtual, you know, that's how I get news out to people.
Fans expect to be able to connect one-on-one with bands.
You are the masters of heavy metal! You rule! You rule! You rule out here!
Before, it was pretty much you went to see the show or you saw the music video, and that was really the only visual impression or interaction you had with a band.
Monty and I, Monty Connor from Roadrunner, and I actually spoke about this before, that a lot of social networking, though, I feel cuts down on the mystique about bands. You can find out when somebody took a crap, you know? There's no mystique, like, what are they doing backstage? Like, who do they hang out with? What are they dressed like? What's on their rider? The curtain has been pulled back a lot.
You know, when I was growing up and, you know, I was into bands like Carcass or Paradise Lost or whatever, you know, they were like a world away. The thought of having any interaction at all with them was like insane, because beyond Metal Maniacs and a few stateside zines, information was very, you know, sparse.
If I had had the ability to be a fly on the wall during, you know, South of Heaven, or, you know, Rust in Peace, or, you know, The Ritual, or anything like that, when that, if I'd had that ability, it would have blown my mind. It would have been amazing for me to see that, and I think that it's, those are the great things about it, because you get to see into these people's lives and really experience the music in a way that you never got to before.
I think it's so cool to be able to connect with real people rather than just having these firm walls that a fan cannot get past.
Interweb bad!
Better fucking believe it. So it's like so much more difficult to track down the dickless cocksuckers who try to steal our music with the motherfucking Napster.
Napster bad!
File sharing, though, in general, hurts the bands, man. You know, it hurts the bands. These guys want to feed their kids, pay their mortgages, pay a bill or two.
I think right now people take music for granted a lot more because of the internet. You don't value anything more than you do when you actually pay for it.
It's taught a generation to not place any value on music, any monetary value on music. You know what I mean? Like, I can get this for free. This isn't actually worth anything, you know? These songs don't, they're not worth anything. They're not even like, they're not even really here, you know? It's like a little digital icon, and all I have to do is move it to my trash and it's gone. It barely exists. Why am I paying money for that?
And some people are gonna say it's wrong, it's stealing, and you know, all that, you know, which may be true. But I think that's not accepting kind of just the way the technology is. You know, I think instead of regulating the people, you should regulate the technology.
Now we have to actually almost like ask people to buy our music, like they're doing us a favor, it seems like, as, you know, don't download this, like, you know, support the band or something. Before it was like, well, you know, if you wanted to support the band, you had to buy the CD, you didn't have a choice, or you could borrow it from your friend. Like CDRs, that scared people when that first came out.
Is the volume of this device at a level where two or more persons could hear audio material? What are you doing in here? Holding little black market concerts in your bedroom?
You're lucky if you see bands, you know, make it without an album leak 6 days, you know, prior to the release date. We get excited over something like that. So it's bound to happen. It's inevitable. But sometimes that's kind of what also brings those baby bands onto the radar.
It's just time for the gatekeepers to figure out a way to make money on it. I mean, this thing's been going on for almost 10 years already. It's crazy. If they would have just gotten on board with it and figured out a way to monetize that behavior rather than trying to change that behavior back to the way it used to be, I feel like the record industry as a whole would be in a totally different state.
My sister's a recording artist, you bastard! How do you explain 2 million view counts on her MySpace page and only 5,000 copies of her single sold? There's a fucking discrepancy there that can only be explained by sick fucks like you!
When you look back at the way the music industry went, when we went from vinyl to cassette to CD. When CDs came out, we partnered with the Philips Corporation, who still makes a percentage of every CD sale that's sold. And we went out and said, hey, here's a brand new technology, a brand new way to get your music, and we introduced it to the public. And so the public said, oh, I love tapes, and I love this, and here's a new way, this is great. Instead of doing that when MP3s came around, we said, oh no, that's, what are you talking about? We don't deal with that. What do you, no, that's, that doesn't exist. So MP3s were introduced to the world through computers and through friends and through people saying, hey, check out this, this is how you get it, this is what you do. And by the time we decided to say, hey, let's catch up and get on board with this, it was so far gone that there was a generation of kids who were raised understanding that this is how you get music. You type it online and you download it and you get it for free. And again, it's hard for me to be mad at them. It's hard for me to say I don't understand it. I just wish they didn't do it.
We're lucky enough that metal kids are loyal to the bands, and you know, they're geeks at heart, and they want like the fancy fold-out packaging and the poster, and they want the vinyl and whatever else. They will actually go out and buy it as well. So we haven't been as hurt as far as the illegal downloading and what have you, as much as say the pop industry has. But we've definitely felt a brunt of it. But then you have to think in other ways. It's like, you know, like, yeah, the music industry is like social Darwinism. It's survival of the fittest. You have to do other stuff.
And I think that's just where things are trending towards, like more collectible items, more, you know, lower print run, but higher value.
I've noticed a lot of labels in their ads, and Decibel recently have been like putting in like t-shirt CD combo. You know what I mean? And that's like, you know, you can't download a t-shirt. Not yet. Maybe by the time this is out, you can. I don't know.
But the problem is there's just so many kids out there where even if they love a band or they love the album, they just download it and that's it. They never buy it.
I think we've come a long way from the days of Metallica versus Napster. Bands make their music available to stream and full album streams and all that stuff. So people can't say, I download it just to try it and now I'm going to buy it if I like it or not. They've had a chance to try the music. They have YouTube and they have Last.fm. They have MySpace. So I think file sharing doesn't have as many legitimate arguments as it used to.
As I've gotten older, you realize that, look, if we're not helping support talented people, it'll be harder and harder for them to survive being talented.
Somebody's really talented and they don't get a chance to write, to full-time dedicate themselves to writing their songs because they're not going to make any money off of it. So who knows, maybe the next great song won't get written because of that.
You know, everybody was yelling the sky is falling for years and years and years, and it has to a degree, but I think everybody's like kind of trying to figure out where the bottom is. You know, are we there yet? And then once we kind of hit it, then we can kind of plan to, you know, move in whatever direction it works after that.
Basically, the bottom line about that is whatever the internet takes away from you, it gives back to you. So I just wish they could figure out, make all the things go into one box. You know, just one box. The phone, the camera, the game, the computer, the hair dryer, the microwave oven, the electric cigarette thing, flashlight, and a beeper that goes with your keys. So when you lose them, you can just hit a button. It goes beep, 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 I'm over here. You can even have it be your voice. I'm over here, wouldn't that be funny?
You blocked me on Facebook. You blocked me on Facebook. You blocked me on Facebook.